informal group called the Jamestown Jammers Backers. It's a group of pretty well Jamestown businessmen and women, and I'd like to thank them also for being instrumental in bringing this event to Warren, especially a couple of folks, Greg Peterson and Mayor Sam Teresi from Jamestown, have been instrumental in bringing this, so I thank them. I would also like to thank the Pirate Organization, and especially Steve Blass, for taking time out of what I'm sure is a very busy schedule now to come up to Northwest Pennsylvania and talk a little bit about Pirate baseball. So we very much appreciate Steve coming. I'd also like to urge all of you, and especially the folks here from Warren, to go up and see a game this year if you haven't been up. Obviously, last year the Jammers became a Pirate affiliate. The Jammers organization has a lot of different programs and things they can do for around employees and employers. And we urge all of you business owners out there to take advantage of those options and take in a game. It's inexpensive entertainment. These are young professional athletes that you may very well see in a Pirate uniform someday.
What a beautiful day, and just baseball's in the air, and just to see the turnout of people from the local area is just as exciting for me as a general manager for the baseball team in the area to see everybody come out and support the Jammers, support the Pirates. I want to thank Steve for coming up.
That was pretty wonderful. And in fact, that's the first time I've been introduced in the last 20 years without getting booed. That's especially wonderful. We do have a good bit of ground to cover today in a short amount of time, but as Elizabeth Taylor told each one of her 8 husbands, don't worry, I won't keep you long. I would like to, if I could just make a quick announcement. I'd love to hear what you are interested in. So I don't have anything to do on Friday night when they come back. So I can stay as long as you like. I know some people have jobs. I don't. I go watch baseball games. But I'd love to hear any questions you might have later on. I brought along some pictures. I've only got a few thousand left. So if you'd like one. There is a fee involved. It's $5. That's the most I can pay you to take one. But just a word about Kent DeCulvey. I'm kind of pinch hitting, which is kind of an honor for me because I became a pitcher because I could hit. But Teek couldn't be here. Teek has had some heart issues. And in fact, as we speak, he's on the list to receive a new heart. And as a result, he can't be more than 2 hours away from Pittsburgh. So I was happy to help him out. He certainly helped a lot of Pirate pitchers out in the 9th inning. So we're kind of hoping for a save for Teek. So keep him in your thoughts, please. When I found out I was going to be coming up, I got very excited because I do a lot of this, do a good bit of this. But without trying to live in the past, I have wonderful memories about my life in baseball up to this point, hopefully more. But I was coming up here, driving up here, knowing that I was going to revisit a very special time in my life, 1961, when I played for the Batavia Pirates. And all through my minor league career, special things, and I'll get into that. But playing in Batavia, that was my first full season of professional baseball. I played in the rookie league. But I was going to play for a professional team, full season, and 1961 was a terrific year for myself. And the fact that my wife was not she wasn't my fiance yet, but I did one of the bad things. My girlfriend from high school, who I just celebrated my 50th anniversary last year, we've been married 50 years, so that's been great. But we were just dating at the time, and I went up to Batavia, and I started dating a girl in Batavia. And then my girlfriend and my dad drove to Batavia. And I left 2 tickets for them and 1 for this lady from Batavia. And damn if they didn't put the 3 of them together. We're still married. not the girl from Batavia, nice lady, but my wife and I. And, so you make rookie mistakes along the way, but it all turned out quite well. Coming up from Florida to play in Batavia, what an introduction. I'm from Connecticut, so I'm from the north, and I know weather. Coming up to start a baseball season in April in Batavia, we walked out from our bus after driving all the way from Florida. That was Class D ball. We didn't fly. Getting off the bus, walking into the ballpark in Batavia and seeing about 2.5 feet of water in each dugout. So that was a little introduction. But I did find a place to stay in Batavia, a rooming house. This lady rented me a bedroom, one room, for $1 a night. $8. Now, how does that work? Isn't there seven? No. So anyway, it worked out very, very nicely. In Jamestown, I have my Jamestown story because this gentleman's name was already mentioned, Jim Rooker. Jim Rooker played for Jamestown. That was a Detroit affiliate at that time, 1961. And Rook was there as an outfielder. He didn't sign as a pitcher. He became a pitcher that, ironically, we each won 103 Major League Baseball games. But he was an outfielder then, and I was striking everybody out, I tell you, I had like 220 strikeouts, some crazy number, really good year. And Rook was an outfielder with Detroit, and I was just blowing him away. I struck him out all the time. And he tells this story, and I got to believe him, because he only has two stories that are true. He told me that he decided that because he couldn't hit me, one afternoon he knew I was going to pitch. Just before he went to the ballpark, he drank 3 beers, and he went 3 for 4. And I said, Jim, that's where it all started for you, wasn't it? But we've become great friends, and to the point where when Rook was broadcasting after he retired in 1980, the Pirates were auditioning a fourth broadcaster just because they needed two on radio and two on television. And I auditioned and some other guys, and he went up to the people at KDK and said, stop messing around, hire Blass. So I got a lot of help from Jim Rooker, and I've never forgotten that. And that's part of the fraternity of baseball buddies and brothers and alumni and all that. So Jim and I are still close. The minor league system, I mentioned that was Class D. There was Rookie League, D, C, B, A, AA, and AAA. Minor league baseball is critically, critically important. We all read about the economics, how much these ball players are making. Why did I even say that? They just get paid by the year. They get paid by the heartbeat. These guys go to sleep at night and they make $43,000. What sweet dreams. But they're such an important part. And I'm still a believer that the more time you spend in the minor leagues, the more prepared you are be a major league ball player. The closer you are to perfecting your craft. Now, guys are rushed up now. We had expansion, so there's more bodies needed. I understand that. But everybody wants Gregory Polanco to be in the big leagues with the Pirates, especially because they're not hitting. What about the rest of his game? Does he hit cutoff men? Does he know how to run the bases? There's a lot involved, so you just can't bring up Gregory Polanco to play for the Pirates now because he's hitting 400. Although, you're likely to see him pretty soon the way they're swinging the bats, or not swinging the bats. Hell, I think I could go out and pitch against him right now. Don't say that. They'll be fine. But the minor leagues are important, and I remember that because what you have to realize, a young man starting out as a professional baseball player, it is your dream. For 90% of us, that was our dream since we were 8 years old. And now you get a chance to play professional baseball, and you work your way up, and you learn your craft, and people fall by the wayside through inability or lack of talent as they go up, or injuries, or homesickness, or whatever. It's a thin line. Pirates in 1960 signed 42 boys. 3 years later, there were 7 of us left out of that group, moving on through the system. But we wouldn't have had it any other way because we were living our dream. How many people get a chance to live their dream? And I'm still living it. I really am. It's my 54th year with the Pirates. And for that reason, I bring up that point because the Pirates gave me a chance to live my dream. And people will say, well, the Cardinals could have signed you, or the Cubs, or the Yankees, or Dodgers. They didn't. The Pittsburgh Pirates did. And for that reason, they will have my loyalty for the rest of my life. I will never quit on them. Pittsburgh Pirates gave me that chance, and that is so very important. So I salute what you do in Jamestown, because I went through the whole process. I played rookie league, I played D, back down to B, and then up to AAA, to the big league. So I know how that works. I know the disappointments. I know what happens when that dream is crushed, when a player gets released. It's the end of a dream. It's kind of a weird process, but it's so worth it. Obviously, when you get to the big leagues and you have that dream fulfilled. So I went through all that and played in Batavia and a lot of other places. Took my wife to the Dominican Republic 2 days after we married. She doesn't bring it up a lot anymore, but that was not much fun. Trujillo had just been assassinated, the dictator, and it was pretty wild. It was kind of a different honeymoon. So it all worked out. Mosquito nets. We went to live with this family when we were down 2 days after we were married, and we go into the house, and it's kind of a European kind of feel. This lady had a bidet. I didn't know what a bidet was, but I know it wasn't a water fountain. That's all I know. We survived that. And I went down there and learned a slider, and that helped me get to the big leagues. So I went through all that process. But I have to tell you a story about getting called up to the big leagues, because every major league athlete remembers the day and the circumstances when you go either from college into football or you go from the minor leagues to baseball. Everybody remembers the call. And I was pitching in Columbus, Ohio with the Columbus Jets. My wife and I got a small apartment in Columbus, so I was pitching there. And we make a road trip to Syracuse, New York, played a doubleheader one night. I pitched the second game, so we've got a bus that's going back from Syracuse to Columbus. I pitched the second game, pitched well. But now, I mean, it's like forever. We get on the bus around 2 o'clock in the morning. We roll into Columbus at about 6:30, 7 o'clock in the morning. I go straight to bed. So at 10 o'clock down this little apartment, the phone rings. My wife answers and says, hello. And this male voice says, I need to speak to Steve. She says, well, he was up in Syracuse last night. He's a professional athlete. And I was on a bus all night. And he's sleeping because they traveled all night. And I'm not going to wake him up. He said, I really need to talk to him. She said, listen, mister. Did you just hear what I said? He's a professional athlete, and he needs his rest. He's been traveling all night, and I am not going to wake him up. And then that voice said, Mrs. Blass, my name is Joe Brown. I'm the general manager of the Pittsburgh Pirates, and we want Steve to come up and pitch for the Pirates. And the next thing you heard in that apartment was, get your ass out of bed and don't wake up. Been pretty much in control since. I came up to the Pirates as a rookie, naive as a lot of rookies are. And I think a lot of the kind of the strange things that happen to rookies because you're vulnerable and you're a little bit gullible. And I was no different. I remember one of my first starts, might not have been the first one, but I had a chance to pitch against Sandy Koufax. And I got very excited. I called everybody, all my family back in Falls Village, Connecticut, small town. Only took about three dimes back then. And I told Mom and Dad, I said, I'm pitching Saturday night. It's going to be against Koufax. And tune in early, because I'm not sure how long I'm going to be around. So Saturday comes, and I want to tell you how nervous I was. It was a 7 o'clock game, and I got the ballpark at noon. And, the adrenaline's going, finally it's time to warm up. I'm down the right field line at Forbes Field. I'm throwing as hard as I can. And at that point, Sandy Koufax came up out of the Dodgers dugout, picked up a ball, went down to the dugout, and the first pitch he threw was faster than I'd never seen anything in my life. And at that point, Bill Mazeroski came up in the back of me, tapped me on the shoulder, pointed to Koufax and said, pitch a shutout, kid, and we'll play for a tie. Thanks, Bill. But rookie year, I had a couple good games. I beat Don Drysdale, as a matter of fact, my first major league start. Pitched a complete game. It was wonderful, a dream fulfilled. And I had one other game. I won five games. Not bad for a rookie. But I had a situation I had in Houston, Texas. First year down in the Astrodome. And pitched a ball game. I won it 9-2. That was one of my five wins. And they got me a bunch of runs, so that certainly helps. And the only guy I had trouble with that night was Jimmy Wynn, the left fielder. They used to call him the toy cannon. A little guy like this just hit the ball forever. He had a home run, two doubles, and a single. Nobody else touched me. So we go from there to L.A., finish the trip to San Francisco, come back, homestand. Now we're going to go back to Houston and play. So Danny Murtaugh remembered my game that I'd had the previous trip down to Houston because I hadn't won any since. I said, you're going to start the first game of the series because I've done well. So at that time, with the Pirates, and I think they still do, when you get into a town, you're going to have a first game of a series. The starting pitcher that night will have the opposing team's lineup, the Houston lineup, and you go over those players to see how you're going to pitch to them, whether you're going to pitch to them that they're going to try to pull the ball or hit it the other way or try to crowd them, whatever you're going to do. And the starting pitcher runs that meeting. So they also remembered, my teammates, that I had done well the time before. So we kind of skipped over everybody and really concentrated on how I should pitch to Jimmy Wynn. Fine with me. So without hardly talking to anybody, we decided we'd try to crowd him with fastballs, sliders away, fastballs in, sliders away, set him up with a slow curveball. Sounded good to me. Nothing else had worked the previous time. So we finish the meeting, we go out, and we go up in the first, top of the first inning, 1-2-3, bang, bang, bang. They get us out. I go out to start the bottom of the first, and lo and behold, Jimmy Wynn is the leadoff batter. I think they remembered also, and they wanted to have him have more shots at me. So, old dummy here, I got the meeting right in my mind. I start him out with a slider right on the outside corner, strike one. Moving back off the plate with a fastball, okay, right according to the meeting. Another slider outside, fouls it off. Another fastball inside, 2-2. I got him right where I want him, right? Catcher puts down two fingers, the slow curveball. I wind up, come over the top, big, slow, overhand curveball, swing and miss, strike three, and he's the only guy I got out that night. It was crazy. The four guys in McDonald's came in. They ran around the bases. It was chaos. So as a result of those kind of things happening my rookie year, I was sent down to the Florida Winter Instructional League, which is a league that takes place after a regular season, whether it's major leagues or minor leagues. You take your highly regarded prospects and you send them down to Florida, and you go over a lot of the fundamentals that will apply all through the Pirate organization, so that if you're in the minor leagues, when you get to Pittsburgh, you'll know some of these plays. And so we worked a lot about all those things and fundamentals. And while we're down there working on them, the Pirates signed a boy by the name of Harold Clem. And he was everything that a Harold Clem should be. Tall farm boy from Iowa, could throw a cherry through a battleship. Pirates signed him to a professional contract and sent him down to the instruction league. Well, of course, we played all the tricks on him that you play on rookies. We sent him after left-handed bats. We sent him for the key to the batter's box. The problem was he found these things, you see. Should have known Harold was a little... So now we got Harold and the whole crew on an afternoon, hot afternoon, down in Pirate City. We're sitting out in the outfield grass. Our manager sits us all down, and we go over one of our very basic defensive Pittsburgh Pirate defensive plays. And we spent 2 hours out there. And it's very simple, and it involves our defense when we know a team's going to try a double steal. You know, double steal, guys on first, guys on third. When our pitcher throws the pitch, the guy from first takes off for second. The catcher throws it down to second. While he's doing that, the guy from third steals home. That's a double steal. We have a very simple play to defend that, the double steal. And we're not trying to, you know, house the homeless, feed the hungry. 2 hours out there. And it's very simple. When we are in the field and we find out that our opponents are going to try the double steal with their runners on first and third, we alert everybody, okay? And so when our pitcher goes into the stretch, he throws the pitch, the guy takes off from first to steal second, right? So when he takes off, the catcher gets the pitch and guns it through like he's going to throw it a second, but the key is for our pitcher just to reach up, pick it off, throw it right back to the catcher, and you get the guy coming in from third base. Not rocket science. 2 hours in the hot sun. 2 hours. The next day, as fate would have it, we're playing the White Sox over in Sarasota. We've got them 2-1. In the bottom of the ninth. They're hitting the bottom of the ninth. They've got runners on first and third with 2 outs. And we've got fabulous Harold Clem out on the mound. And Harold's enjoying himself. He's watching the airplanes land at Sarasota International. He's watching the grass grow there. And he's better working on that farm back in Iowa. And at that point, we find out they're going to try the double steal, the White Sox. This is great. 2 hours yesterday, we worked on our play. So our manager gives our defensive play signal to the infield, they've got it. The outfielders have got it, the catcher's got it, the parking lot attendant across the street. We are so ready for these guys. Fabulous Harold goes into the stretch, throws the pitch, the runner takes off from first to steal second, the catcher races up, guns it through, and Harold ducks. We still got a chance because our second baseman very alertly cuts across in front of second, picks it off, guns it back to the catcher, and now Harold's got it. Harold's got it. Harold's back in Iowa now. He left right after we had the services for the manager, so I hope he's doing well. Yeah, I really do. But you got to consider, when I came up as a rookie, I never went to college. I couldn't have gotten into college. I mean, I had to take home and family living my senior year, graduate. I flunked driver ed. One of the reasons was my wife, girlfriend at the time, Karen, was in the back seat with me while they were driving up in front. So I got an A+ in the back seat, but I got a D. I drive now, so. But what I really consider myself as having gone to the University of Baseball, because my professors, Roberto Clemente, Bob Prenn, Vernon Law, Elroy Pace, Mazeroski, Dick Grobe, I couldn't have walked into a better environment, a more professional environment. And they helped me not only become proficient in pitching and everything, but they helped me go from being a ball player to a major leaguer. And there's a difference. There's a difference with your responsibility to yourself, your team, your community, fans. There's a lot of things that you need to be to go from being a ball player to a major leaguer. And those guys helped me enormously. I will never forget what they did to help me become a major leaguer. And that's big. I mean, that's absolutely huge. And so I survived the minor leagues and I got to the World Series. And I have to tell you about the World Series. Outside of my family, it's one of the huge things in my life. That dream of now even playing baseball, do I possibly dare to dream about playing in a World Series? And I wear this ring because we did. And when I look at this ring, I don't think about the check we got. It was, that was nice. But I think about all those guys I went through that experience with. From 30 games in spring training, 162 regular season games, playoffs, and we wound up being the world champions. And it means everything. I look at that and you can't buy these things. You gotta earn them. And it made everything worthwhile. It made all those dreams worthwhile to come up and be a part of that. And play on the same team that had Roberto Clemente right here. That World Series was his showcase. It showed everybody in baseball what we had been seeing around here for 20 years. What was it, 43 years now. I remember two plays that Clemente made that did not result in outs. I have that image. I can't put it on a computer. I don't do computers. I touched my wife's computer once and the garage door went up. So I don't do anything. But I have that image. Clemente coming over to the right field line, making a 360 and throwing a strike to Hebner at third base. Safe. Didn't get an out. Another time Clemente's on the warning track. Somebody hit a ball down the right field line. It goes around the corner like a hockey puck around the boards. Clemente picking it up on the warning track and throwing a one-hopper to Sanguia on home plate. Didn't result in that. But I have images of watching him play. He was magic. You didn't want to take your eye off him. You didn't want to miss anything. It was an honor. I tell people he was my hero, he was my teammate, and my friend. And that's a pretty good combination. However, he had a little streak in him that I went up to him after I was there with the Pirates long enough to talk to him, because we all had him up on this pedestal. And I went over when thought I was okay to be on his team, and I said, hey, Roberto, here's the deal. If I ever get traded, I'm gonna pitch you inside, because everybody in the National League pitches you away. You get 350 every year. He said, Blass, I'm going to tell you one thing. You pitch me outside, I hit the ball to Harrisburg, or inside. I'd mess that up, but he did tell me that. But I also told him after the World Series, I said, I know you got the car, got a sports car for being the most valuable player, but you know, I had a couple complete games, I should at least get the tires. And then he said something to me in Spanish that I can't repeat. I I never did get the tires. But being a part of that group and teammates, I mentioned some of them, but one of my favorite teammates was also mentioned here, Manny Sanguin. Every time you see him, he's got this big smile on his face. Everybody that plays Major League Baseball loves to play the game, or you wouldn't have gotten there. But there are some guys that wear that on their sleeve. Anytime you watch Manny Sanguin playing, you knew that he was having the time of his life. Now, the thing about Sanguin was that he spoke better English in 1966 when we bought him up from Panama than he does now. I just saw him last week at his barbecue. I said, "How you doing?" He had this big smile on his face. We talked for 20 minutes. I don't have a clue. But he's one of the greatest examples of confidence I've ever seen, because people ask me, what comes first for a major league athlete, confidence or success? My contention is, before you have true confidence, you have got to have succeeded. Then you know. You don't think you are good. You know. You've proven it by doing it. However, there are some exceptions, and Sanguin probably is, to me, the greatest exception I've ever heard of, because we bought him up from Panama in 1966. He signed his first major league contract on a Wednesday morning for $7,000. The minimum now is $520,000. Not $1,000. Anyway, Wednesday morning, he signs his first major league contract, $7,000. At 2 o'clock that afternoon, he goes out and buys a $15,000 Cadillac. He's been in the big leagues approximately 4 hours. He's only $8,000 in the hole. That's confidence. That is confidence. Now, I had the honor of pitching to Manny Sanguin when he caught his first major league game. It was in Chicago at Wrigley Field. And I had that honor. And so we're getting ready for the game, and we're all saying, he's going to catch, I'm going to pitch. So we go out, top of the first inning, he goes up, bang, 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 1, 2, 3. I go out to start the bottom of the first inning, talk about bang, 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 2 base hits and a walk. I got the bases loaded. I think I can still hear the anthem. It's that quick. And now there's nobody out, there's the bases loaded, and Ernie Banks is coming to the plate. Hall of Famer, over 500 home runs. And I'm in a jam. And now Manny Sanguin, at that point, bases loaded, nobody out, his first major league catching experience, turns around the umpire and has his first major league pitcher's conference. Turns around, time out, comes trotting out, lifts his mask up, got a big smile on his face, says, "Oh, you know," and then he goes back. So he goes down and puts one finger down. I threw a fastball, and Ernie hits it into Lake Michigan. I guess at that point I did not. But it gets worse, because now we go down to Atlanta. 5 days later, it's my turn to pitch again, and Manny's going to have his second major league catching assignment. Lucky me. So we go out, same thing, deja vu. Bang, 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 they get us out. I go out the bottom of the first. Base hit, walk, infield single. Bases loaded again, nobody out. Only it's not Ernie Banks this time, it's Henry. Hank Aaron. How good is that? So at that point, Manny decides to have his second ever Major League Pitchers Conference. Turns around the umpire. Here he comes. Mask up, big smile on his face. Says, "Oh, you throw a double play. Like you can call Sears and order a double play." That's it. So he goes back down, he puts 3 fingers down for the slider. So I wind up, I let go of the ball. Do you ever have those dreams where everything slows down? I let go of the ball, and as the ball gets closer and closer to Henry, Henry's eyes get bigger and bigger, and he just crushes the ball. But he doesn't get under, line drive to left field, left center field, knocks about 3 bricks out of the wall at Fulton County Stadium. All runners, all 3 runners score. Henry's on second, 3-run double, Sanguin. Here he comes, lifts a mask, big smile on his face, says, "I know say double, I say double play." By that time, Murtaugh's out there, and I got excused. So those are some of the things that can happen. But I have to tell you, a couple stories about another teammate, not necessarily my favorite, but probably one of the most interesting, Vic Davalio. Vic played for the Indians, had a good major league career. I think he hit like 315 one year. I mean, he was a good player. But we couldn't take Vic to Chicago because we played day games. And Vic drank a lot. I mean, a lot. The problem was, at that point, Chicago was all day games. So Vic would be on the street at 4 o'clock in the afternoon in Chicago. Not good. Not good. So now, he comes to the clubhouse one morning in Chicago, and he is still smoked. Sad to say it, but he is still cranked. So we decide we're going to hide him from Danny Murtaugh. So we hit him in the dryer. Vic in the dryer. Small guy. We put him in, had the window in front, so we put one of our little shortstops in front of the dryer so nobody hit the button, because you see Vic and something around the dryer. So we got him hidden up in there, so we go down, we're into the ball game, and I don't need the mic because I gotta show you what happened here. Danny Murtaugh says, "Get Vic. I want him to pinch hit." And we all say, "Nah, Danny, you don't want Vic today." "Get Vic down here." So I go run up in the clubhouse, I get Vic out of the dryer. Still in the gong show. So he comes down there, and he's in the on-deck circus, 30,000 people standing there, or watching, and Vic's up there, and now he goes up to hit, and Vic had this mechanism. Remember Ty Cobb? Ty Cobb had one of the, he'd raise that leg, and that was his timing to be a hitter. Just raise that front foot, and that would be his timing. So now Fergie winds up, and Vic goes up, fastball. Where'd that come from? Now, he's gonna trick Fergie. He's going to go up early for the fastball. So Fergie winds up, lets the ball go, and Vic, he throws him a changeup. Vic's up there too long. He falls in. Steve Swisher, the Cubs catcher, now has a drunk Venezuelan in his arm. Nobody knows where the damn ball is. We've got 30,000 people that have paid $20 each to watch this. So the other tough situation that happened for Dick Vic was when I was going to pitch one morning, 8:30 in the morning, the bus would come to take us to the ballpark. So I was anxious and excited. So I'm going out to the bus at 7:30 to get on the bus because the bus is there. So I open the door, and of course there's nobody there. It makes me. I look in the back seat, and there's Vic. Vic got so drunk, he decided that he couldn't take a chance on going to the hotel and sleeping through the bus. So he just stayed up all night and got on the bus at 7:30. So I look back and Vic's crushed. And at that point, out of our door of our hotel, the front door, comes Colonel Sanders, Colonel Chicken. And the Colonel's looking good. He's got the white suit, he's got the string tie, he's got the hat, he's got the cane. And the Colonel's stepping out. And Vic, out of the window, looks over, and it's too much for Vic. He doesn't know what this is all about, this guy. So he pulls down the window and says, "Hey, you!" And he gives Colonel Sanders the bird. The great thing is, the Colonel drops the cane and gives it right back to him. I mean, you can't make this stuff up. I wish I'd called all the guys, they'd all bought a ticket to watch this. Those are the kind of things that can happen. What I'm hoping that is going to happen starting tomorrow night is that the Pirates are going to start hitting. Because it's really been a dry spell. I can understand it against Wainwright. He's one of the best in the business. But not everybody is Adam Wainwright. And they've got to start swinging the bats. Because here's what happened last year. And the 2 years before, 11 and 12. 11 and 12, we ran the table with just primarily pitching for 4 months. And it's hard to do it for 6 months. Last year we did. We ran the table in 2013, primarily with our pitching, almost dominantly with our bullpen. We were playing six-inning games. If you didn't get the Pirates by the sixth inning, you weren't going to get them. And the pitching is good right now. It's just not as airtight. Last year, we were winning every game 2-1. Now, because we're not hitting and not pitching lights out, we're losing those kind of games. So the offense has to help the pitching. And it's not just one guy. It's not just Pedro. Pedro's like a lightning rod because he hits monster home runs or strikes out. So when we're not around him scoring some, it's on Pedro. And you can't do it with one person. That's why I tell people, Polanco can't come riding in here and, what's he going to bat four times a game? What if he gets two hits a game, 500? One guy can't do it, so they need to score more. It's as simple as that. You need it out of your shortstop, Mercer. You need more out of Neal at second base, first base and right field. Yep. And now Russell Martin's on the DL with Grilly. So not only what they're doing on the field, but you've got to have your health, because you got your guys, and there's a reason they play every day. Russell Martin plays every day. Stops a running game. It's enough. Melanson's going to be fine, I think, as a closer. He proved that last year. But if the Pirates would score a bunch of runs, it would take the pressure off everybody, because you can't play catch-up baseball every night. You can't be behind in the fourth or fifth inning and have your pitcher knocked out. That disrupts the rotation. That overtaxes your bullpen, and it puts pressure on your hitters playing catch-up every night. You want your hitters up there when you're even or ahead. That's a relaxing at-bat. That's what's going on with the Pittsburgh Pirates. But one thing that you should remember, this is in conjunction with the Jammers too. The Pirates had a streak where we were not signing the right boys. And scouting is such an inexact science, very inexact. Hard to project how an 18-year-old boy will be in 3 years, how a college kid will respond. And so talent evaluation is the key, and it's getting better. We are starting to send better players, first-round choice, to Jamestown, and our farm system is better. Back when I started out, you had to wait your turn. Our farm system was loaded. And before the 71 series, 3 years before that, Hebner came up, Oliver, Robertson, Hebner, Ellis, Moose, Oliver Kleins, all those guys. So you hope to build through that, because we can't write the big checks like a lot of the guys can. So that's what's happening with the Pittsburgh Pirates now. From a personal standpoint, I've got about an hour dialogue on the replays and the home plate business, the collisions, because I'm an old school guy. And baseball is an imperfect game played by imperfect people. That's the way it's been for 100 years. That's why it's the best game. I believe that. I sincerely believe it. And we don't have to chase technology for people. Even if they stray and chase that kind of thing with some other sport, they will come back to baseball. The game is that good. So that's how I feel. The collisions at home plate, hey, you bought your ticket to be a catcher. One of my endearing images is for when a catcher takes a shot and comes out of the dust and he holds the ball up to the umpire. I think that's a great image. Plus the fact, if you get everything exactly right, you're gonna sanitize the game. Where are the stories gonna be in 10 years? Where are the stories that you're gonna remember? So that's it, I'll get off my soapbox on that. But I did want to thank Greg. Greg, thank you. Greg wanted to ask me one question about did I ever hit a home run. Thank you very much, Greg. I did hit one. It was, so long ago, I hardly remember any of the details. It was September 5th, 1969. At Wrigley Field, the temperature is 74 degrees, winds out of the west about 5 miles. 47%, Ken Holzman was a pitcher. There were runners on first and second. 23,412. The rest of it's kind of vague, but thanks. The really neat thing is that's the only true story to tell. But the great thing was running down the first baseline, the coach said, take a left, because I'd always. I know we all have to go to back to work. It's going to take me, till Friday to drive down 62 again. it's a lot of miles, and it's a lot of coffee, and a bumpy road. That's not a great equation. I made it all right. But if you have any questions, I'd be happy to take a shot. Yes?
When you think back on when you exited Major League Baseball, you developed a control kind of problem.
Tell me about it.
What would you attribute that to? And when you think about it, were there things you could have done to prolong that?
Well, it was a different. After the World Series, I won 19 games the next year, and I was second in the Cy Young voting to Steve Carlton. And then the next year, I won 3, and then a year and a half later, I was done. And it was simply control. I never had a sore arm, so it had to be psychological block or whatever it was. And I never did find out what it was. But I spent 2 years going through personal hell, because I know that I shouldn't be out there, but I didn't want to quit. And so I did everything I possibly could to get it back. I thought it might be one little thing, but it was not much fun because, you know, if you're a major league athlete, you're working in front of 30,000 people and you feel like you shouldn't be out there. It's agonizing. It put a tremendous strain on our family, put a strain on the Pirates. Clemente was gone all of a sudden, and I was, for all intents and purposes, from a pitching standpoint, gone. So it was a terrible time, but I still hearken back to the fact that my dad only told me a couple of things when I went to play ball. He said, don't forget where you came from, and he says, you're going to learn more from some failures than you will from success when you're riding the crest. So I didn't quit until I was really convinced that it just wasn't there anymore. And I'm lucky because there's so much more on the positive side of the ledger than the negative side. But it was not much fun. I never found out what caused it. Maybe they have the technology now. Maybe I could go to Harvard Medical School and say, here I am, boys, fix me. But that wasn't around then. But I played 10 years in the big leagues. The average major league career, anybody that ever played for 100 years, is 3.7 years. So I'm in the bonus round. And I live my dreams. I won 100 games. I pitched an All-Star game. I pitched 2 World Series games. I played with Hall of Famers. I mean, Stargell at first, Maz at second, Clemente in right. I said, you know, hit the ball in that direction. I'm going to go get a sandwich. When I come back, you'll be out. So in answer to your question, I did try everything. I did, and I didn't quit until I was thoroughly convinced. And it was the dream taken away because I never had a sore arm. I could have pitched. I had the body then. By the way, this body was not built with steroids, as you can tell. But I could have pitched 6 or 7 more years, and that's what really, really disappointed me. But all things considered, I'm ahead of the game.
Steve, we talk about pine tar. Did you have a secret weapon?
Slider. Any of you read about this Pineda thing with the Yankees? What is this guy thinking about? He's putting pine tar on his neck? He can't get any more creative than that? I mean, come on, go spend a weekend with Gaylord Perry. I'll tell you how to hide it. We all tried a spitball, but in the big leagues, you got to be able to be consistent with these trick pitches for 8 out of 10 times, not just every once in a while. I threw a knuckleball, I tried that. I could throw good for a couple times. But that's not good enough in the big leagues. I threw 2 knuckleballs in the major leagues. Lou Brock hit a home run in St. Louis, and after the game, in a post-game interview, said he hit a hanging slider. That was not really good. And Ernie Banks hit one out, so I didn't pursue the knuckleball. So I didn't try that, but the guys have tried it. Anybody got a baseball nearby? We had a couple of baseballs, yeah. Don't throw it. I can tell a story on Bob Moose because 2 reasons. He's a good friend and he's passed away. But Bob, you got to picture this. A right-hand pitcher, he's got the glove on his hand, right? So the umpire tosses you a ball to warm up, right? Okay. What's the first thing you do? You take the glove off, put it under your arm, and you rub it up. Well, Bob Moose had so much pine tar in this hand, he could do that, and the ball would stay there. The umpire finally caught him. And they told him to take off his glove. It took him 15 minutes to get the glove off. Wait, hold it. It's coming back.
How home is exactly showing off, flipping the bat, you know, if he hits the ball, he's got a home run almost every time he gets up, with the attitude he's got.
Well, you're talking about the incident a week ago, Sunday. I'm sitting up there, Cole is hyper, and I like that. I mean, he has high standards and he's into it. I was the same way. If Gomez did that to me, and I had guys do that kind of stuff to me, flip the bat, run around, go around like he's got a home run, and Garrett Cole said something on the way by, but this guy has a history. I mean, they suspended him, but they really should send him for psychiatric evaluation. Gomez is nuts. And he goes off and everything and all that. And so that started it all. But I'm not surprised. You know, you don't want to be shown up. Remember Davey Concepcion, great shortstop for the Reds. Well, we were in the playoffs, and I'm pitching very good. I beat him one game, and then I'm pitching the next game for Moose throws a wild pitch, and instead of getting a concrete driveway, I get asphalt because we didn't go to the World Series. But now Concepcion is hitting, and he goes up to the plate like this. And he does that, and I got no problem with that. But I walk down off the mound, and I said, "Hey, David, just trying to keep even." I want the big guy playing favorites on me. So, you know, that the worst thing you can have is be shown up.
Well, he's done in Atlanta, as you know.
Pardon me?
He did in Atlanta last year.
Cole?
No,
Gomez. Oh, Gomez. He's nuts.
Why is the baseball addressing this? I mean, are they scared because he's a minority? They're worried about a situation?
No, they'll hit him. All that stuff goes in the file. Along with, was it Maldonado, the guy that sucker punched? That's in the file. That'll be addressed like that.
That was really cheap.
Oh, yeah. It is cheap, but you know, when I was growing up, my father told me one other thing: if you're in a fight, everything's legal. And I weighed 170 pounds, so I was going to go for everything I could. But yeah, Garrett Cole, I just love him. I love him. Yeah, he'll address that too, and he's big enough. Yeah. So, yeah.
Hey, Steve.
Yeah.
Yeah. What about the cycle? I mean, long-time Pirate fans would know. Last year's winning season.
Me
what
too.
What do you think the differences were in the dynamics in the clubhouse? In 2012, they seemed so close. They lasted so long. We were all so hopeful, and then it crashed. Last year, it crashed. What do you think? What's going on?
The pitching stopped being as dominant in 11 and 12. Clubhouse chemistry and the dynamic is a result, not a cause. You've got to be good to have the chemistry. Chemistry does not cause success. Sorry. A lot of people feel that way, and it's a wonderful thing, but it comes from being successful, in my opinion. That's just the way I feel about it. In order to have that close, I don't want anybody happy if you're not winning. That's not what you want. So maybe in the minority, but that's kind of the way I feel about it. Yes?
Yeah, how about pitchers completing a game? It seems like today they pull out pitchers and a reliever comes in, and sometimes the game is blown to the reliever, and the pitcher was doing fine.
How much time you got? When we were given a baseball back in my day, and I'm an old dog, and I'll admit that was an honor to have them give you a brand new baseball. You're going to start tonight. That is your ball game, and that's how we felt. We felt a quality start was seven innings with no more than two runs given up. And more likely, you wanted to pitch the whole game. We're just talking at the table. As a major league pitcher, when you get to the ninth inning, sure, you're tired, but you've got adrenaline going for you. As long as you don't fall into the trap of trying to get all three outs in the ninth inning on one pitch, if you get to that point, you got adrenaline, and plus, you're pitching very well, you wouldn't have gotten to that point. So I think it's a catch-22. They're training these kids to throw 100 pitches, and then when they get up to the big leagues, they're trying, you know, obviously they're going to try to do more, even if it's within 100 pitches. And they're saving their arms. I think they're saving their economics. I think economics have a lot to do with it. And I understand. I understand. My arm was worth $15,000 a year. These kids' arms are worth $4 or $5 million. So I understand the math. But it's almost like a catch-22 because there's more pitchers on the DL than there's ever been in the last 100 years. So I don't know what we're accomplishing with that, but that's the way the world is now. I understand what that is, and the radar gun. We weren't concerned. Our pitch count was fine as long as we were getting people out. If we weren't getting them out, we were getting out. We were out of there, so we didn't need the numbers. And baseball is becoming a game of numbers now, statistics, and that's probably eventually going to cost me my job. But I'm 72, how much more time I got anyway. So but I hate the overabundance of stats, and they're a big part of the game now. So the game is passing me by in that aspect a little bit, but not enough to keep me home. Yes?
I hope you agree with me on this. I watched a lot of baseball in my time. So many situations come up on situation to punt. Why can't a major league ball player punt?
Because they don't practice it enough. Simple. It's like It's like throwing from the outfield. Now you go to a ball game now, do you see infield practice and guys throwing before the game? And it's repetition. Baseball is simply a simple game of repetition. The more you do things, the better you're going to get. The more you do the right things, the better you're going to get. Simple as that. I don't have any other answer.
Steve, how about the replay and taking the umpire out of the game?
Well, I touched on that. I hate the replays. I have a lot of respect for Major League umpires. I think they're as good or better than any group of officials in Major League sports. The play at home plate, it's part of the game. I think it's part of the game, and a lot of catchers will agree with that. I think the Buster Posey broken ankle brought a lot of that to bear because they're paying this guy $100 million, so that obviously they don't want him being hurt. But it's part of the game. And they just came out now that the neighborhood play at second base on a double play, they're saying you have to have possession. Well, you know, that's been the rule for the last 150 years. So, anyway.
Steve?
Yep.
Clemente seemed to have a reputation of being temperamental and maybe a hypochondriac. Was that fair, or was he misunderstood?
Not by the time, maybe it was before I got there, but not when I was there. And he was quoted one time because he kept getting asked. He says, "A hypochondriac cannot produce." I always remember that quote. And he played hard. And he looked like a physical specimen, really did, at 38 when he died. But you talked to Tony Barber, a trainer, he had all kind of stuff going on with disc stuff and neck stuff. He had a lot of issues, so he was hurt, but I had no indication of that, and I might have been looking at it through rose-colored glasses because I didn't want to think anything negative about him. I thought that much positive. So I heard the same things, but that there are certain days he didn't want to play. I didn't see that when I was there, and I came up. You know, he had been there several years before we got there. Yes.
The 1971 World Series, the last game. I wondered a couple things. How difficult was it to focus when you know this is the biggest game in the world? And did it help you when Earl Weaver came out and questioned that where your foot was on the rubber?
Well, first of all, when we lost Game 6 after the last out, Danny Murtaugh says, "Tag, you're it for tomorrow." And I had an idea that was going to happen. You're trained and developed to block things out. And when I, after that incident in the first inning, I was in a bubble. I mean, I was just, it was like the old computers. It would go click, click. I know, okay, I got Boog Powell. I'm going to try to show him hard stuff, but never in the strike zone. I'm going to throw him. So he hit foul balls that were 500 feet, but they were 400 feet foul. So, and that's, I was in that frame of mind. But in the first inning, Earl came out, and you know, I'm going to pitch the seventh game of the World Series, only me and the laundryman. Now, how excited I am. So I go out there in the first inning, I'm throwing the ball all over the place, and Earl comes out, little Earl. It's rule 801, he's not lined up on the rubber properly, which is not the case. As long as you any kind of contact, you're fine. As long as your foot is touching any part of the rubber, you're fine. So we went through that. And every time I saw Earl before he died, I would thank him. I said, "Earl, thanks for, you know, giving me a chance to catch my breath and give me a breather. And I got so upset with you that I forgot about how nervous I was." But and I always would seek him out to make sure I mentioned that to him. He really enjoyed it. So we got on the other side of that. But the toughest time was after the eighth inning. Because they had a threat. They had two guys on, nobody out. They bunted them over, and we got a couple of ground balls. Cost us a run, but still was 2-1. Now they get us out in the eighth inning. I got to pitch the bottom of the eighth inning. So I get through that, and now I'm saying to myself, you talk about the ninth inning. I got three more outs, and we're going to be world champions. I mean, it's just the World Series is everything you think it is times 10. Everything's magnified. And by the way, Danny Murtaugh never made one trip to the mound in a 2-1 seventh game of a World Series. It's phenomenal. Phenomenal. I mean, now, any more like that, you'd be out of there after the seventh inning. But just waiting, we almost scored. The top of the ninth inning took 15 minutes, and the whole game only took 2:20. But I'm pacing down there, And I'm going back, I'm just killing time. I go back into our clubhouse, and there's Bob Prince in his loud jacket back there. I guess I said, "What the hell are you doing here?" He said, "Me? What the hell are you doing in here? Go out. I got work to do after this game is over." And he was down there to do interviews. So I went out, and then we got him out, and all hell breaks loose. But Prince, I just have to tell Bob Prince was the most unique individual in the world. The second game I ever broadcast with him, booze was absolutely forbidden in the radio booth. In the seventh inning of my second game broadcasting, he calls down to the press room and says, "Send up two screwdrivers." I thought something was loose in the booth. And that was only because he used to drink Canadian Club and Coke, and his doctor told him the Coca-Cola was killing him. So he went to screwdrivers. And from that day on until this, until he passed away, I thought there was an orange juice shortage in the United States. That's another story. One thought about heroes. A lot of people talk about baseball players, football players, hockey players being heroes. And my idea of heroes are people that teach and who heal and do things for other people when they are not asked to. So I believe that I'm looking at a lot of heroes, and I've enjoyed the time with you. And let's just go to the ballpark and get some runs for the Pirates. Thanks so much for your time. This group was marvelous. They were into it. They're baseball people, so the more they enjoyed it, the more I kept going.
Shifted to Pittsburgh for Game 3, where Steve Blass grounded the O's with a masterful 3-1 victory.
There's a drive right down to Cash on a short hop. The Buccos win. Look at Blass.
Final confrontation. And once again, Steve Blass took the mound for the Pirates.
I went out to pitch in the bottom of the first inning, and I was all over the place because I wasn't locked in at all. Everything was registering, everything was occurring, and you can't really be too effective. But that's when Earl Weaver tried his psychological ploy and come out and said, "Rule 801.
801. Rule 801 says he's got to pitch from in front, on the rubber in front, and not on his side."
And I think I got so upset with him trying that nickel and dime stuff that it gave me a sense to settle down and forget about all the circumstances around. And after that, really did get back into it and got back in the groove and went from there and really pitched effectively after that.
Walk me through the ninth inning.
Well, the ninth inning, we go out there, and I think I got him on 8 pitches, and this is the heart of their order, because Boog Powell is capable of tying it with one swing of the bat, power hitter. I got him to hit the ground ball to Dave Cash on what I think might have been the 15th slow curve I threw to him in 8 at-bats. He went 0 for 8, 0 for 4, and 0 for 4. I never threw him a strike with anything hard, like a slider or a fastball. It was over the plate. I set him up, got him on another slow curve. And then the interesting thing was Frank Robinson came up, who had hit a home run off me in Game 3 for their only run that game, and I hung a slider. I said, and the minute I let it go, and he popped it up. Even good hitters, it's not automatic that they're going to hit every mistake. And every time I've seen him since, I say, "Hey, Frank, you want that slider back, don't you?" And then he says some nasty things to me.
Pirates 2, Baltimore 1. If Blass gets another out, you'll see a sight. He's very emotional, and he just might explode out there. There's a strike. Now keep your eyes on him. He pitched a 3-hitter at Pittsburgh to beat the Orioles. He's pitched a 4-hitter so far today, and he's leading 2-1.
And then they hit the ball that Hernandez got that I thought was a clean base hit, but I'd forgotten we were shading him up the middle, and then it all goes crazy.
There's a drive up the middle. Hernandez in back of the bag. He's got him, Jackie Hernandez. Look at Blass. Blass has pitched the Pirates to the World Championship. The Pirates, 2 games down, have come back and become the 15th in the World Series history to win the championship after losing the first two. And Jackie Hernandez, supposedly a weak member of the cast, an erratic shortstop, played brilliantly in this series. Here is the Pirates locker room. And Pittsburgh has won its 4th World Championship. 1909, 1925, 1960, and again today.
Coming in here with Chairman of the Board, Mr. John Galvis. Steve, I know you just can't express yourself emotion-wise. You're all run out.
I don't know what to say. This is the biggest thrill that could ever happen. I don't believe it. From a skinny kid from Falls Village, Connecticut.
Well, not so skinny out there. You showed them all there was to show them, Steve. And was there any one moment in that ball game that had you really worried?
There were several. One when they had the two men on, and then one hanging slider I threw to Davy Johnson that he popped up, but he missed the pitch. I can't believe how many people have this kind of an opportunity.
Well, you rose right to the occasion.
And the best part is you can't do that now. I found a way somehow to sneak my dad into the clubhouse after the last out. So it's all good.
The catcher is running towards the camera at full speed. His upraised arms spread wide. His body is tilting towards the center of the picture. His mask is held in his right hand. His big glove is still on his left hand. His mouth is open in a gigantic shout of pleasure. That's what Roger Angel described the picture. The 1971 picture of you and Manny Sanguian. Capture that moment for you.
Well, you know, the thing is, I had won the seventh game of the World Series 1,000 times in my backyard when I was 10 years old. Yeah. And, you know, you dream, what would I do? What would I do if I was pitching and got the last out in the seventh game of the World Series? And, of course, when it occurs, you go crazy. It's just such a release of emotion. Some guys get down on the ground. I ran towards Sanguian, and I jumped on Bob Robertson. The perfect guy, because he's huge. It was just such a release, because you can't prep for that. You can't even think about it in the ninth inning. But after the last out, they hit the ball to Jackie Hernandez, and it was by me. I thought it was a base hit, and if it was a base hit, they would have bought a reliever, and Dave Justy was our closer. But I turned around, it's going to him. I said, catch it, and then he caught it, and I said, throw it. And then I turned around, you catch it. So we had a 1-2-3 ABC. And then you go berserk, the release. It's over. I don't have to work anymore. They'll never change this. We are the world champions. It is final. They can't adjust it, and that's forever for this particular year.
Even today, when you go online and you look at this top 10 pitching performances in World Series history, this is not Pirates. This is history. And there's a picture of one Steve Blass. Does that, you have to pinch yourself?
Yeah, I do. I'll look down and say, I did this stuff. I mean, I worked out there, even regular games. That's, I don't know, that's tough stuff. You know, sometimes I think, I'm not sure I did all that stuff, but it's documented.
Well, even Earl Weaver was quoted as saying, Clemente was great, all right, but if it hadn't been for Mr. Blass, we, the Orioles, might be popping the corks right now. And, I mean, that's the...
Well, you know, those are two superior games, a three-hitter and a four-hitter against a team that won 100 games, 420-game winners, and you give them a run in each game, and complete games. There has not been a complete game since by a National League pitcher in the seventh game of a World Series, a winning pitcher. It's not happened since 71, and it probably won't. The bullpens are so strong now. You're so consumed during the course of the game. It's a wonderful bubble. I mean, there's nothing happening. There's no crowd. You don't hear a crowd. It is like those old computers that go click, click. All right, I'm going to try to set Boog Powell up for a slow curve, but I got to do this. I got to show him a fastball, sinking fastball, so I know it's far enough outside. I don't make a mistake. But after the game, it's just a pure vein of joy. I have 8x10s of a couple of cards I passed out today. Of me running towards Sanguian, and all I do is sign joy in my name.